So let's get into it. Our keynote with Seth Troxler. We're going to go all over the place with this discussion, but let's start with what you're up to personally. You've launched two new labels.
Three.
All right. Over the last couple of months. Tell us, it's hard enough launching one label, so why have you launched three and what are they all about?
Recently I've launched three new projects. I kind of stepped back creatively and in a management way from Vision Quest and have now just started three new projects. One's called Play It, Say It. That first release just came out from Sharam. And the idea behind Play It, Say It was as a big room DJ occasionally, as Pete and I both are, I started to find it kind of hard to find music for those situations, for certain situations, and also finding music that is contemporary but doesn't sound as if every other kind of big hit label sounds, you know, everything kind of in a certain way. And there's also a thing I found that like there's a lot of older kind of great big producers who've got all this music that they are making, but no one's releasing, you know? So I've got some stuff from Trauma, I got a track from Bushwaka and some other older people, and I'm like, hey, these are great songs made for DJs, you know, made in a way that they sound, how the progression and everything is of the tracks, you know, the compositions are done in a different way, you know? And I really wanted to put out that music. A lot of these guys give me these tracks all the time. I play them throughout the year. They work and they're not coming out. And I was like, well, you know, before when I was with Vision Quest, a lot of the music didn't really fit there. And then it just came to a point like, why am I just sitting on this music? It should come out. You know, it should come out in a way that's just like, hey, you know, the concept. I used to work at a record store and they used to have these stickers for radio announcers like Pete to say, when you play the record, please say what record it is so people go out and buy it. And I always thought that was really cool. They're like, when you play it, say it. So I was like, that's perfect. These are records for people to play and to talk about and to be heard on, like, you know, do they work? They're records that work. They're hits. You know, like an old kind of club record or whatever, pop record. Then the second label, I started with the Martinez brothers. It's called Tuskegee. Tuskegee is a school in Mississippi. It was like one of the first intellectual kind of think tanks or first place that people of color could really be educated at a higher level in America ever. And there's this idea I'd been thinking about for a long time. I really love the name. And also I've kind of noticed that there has become a lack of ethnic diversity within music and the ethnic perspective. Predominantly, I know historically how dance music was made. There is a huge diverse culture. I mean, I have a great anecdote there. Recently, I was at Panorama Bar and with my friend David, and there's this guy with one of the original Paradise Garage shirts, and the original shirts had they glue in the dark. My friend David had the same one, and so he goes up to the guy. They start talking or whatever, and we're at Panorama Bar. You know, it's this debaucherous whatever place. And he goes, well, hey, what's different here than what was at the garage? And the guy's like, you know, we have the music, you have the gay culture, you know, that's cool, it's going on, you know, people are engaged. But he's like, there's no diversity here, you know? It's mostly European, mostly Caucasian, you know? So it's like, hey, what have we really lost? And that is diversity, you know? And now we're starting to lose diversity also in economic class of the people who are allowed to even go to clubbing, you know? So it came to this idea, and the Martinez brothers being from the Bronx and me from Detroit, and in many ways, the reason we are here today is because we revolted against the idea of the stereotypical kind of consumer image of what ethnic youth should be like. So we're like, hey, let's create a platform, both clothing and music, almost like a lifestyle brand, for young aspiring people of kind of young urban youth to kind of look at, you know, like whether they're, I mean, we're predominantly releasing music from people of ethnic backgrounds, so either like kind of Latino, Mexican, African American, we've even got a couple kind of Arab people, because growing up and being of color, I mean, it's hard, and it's not a thing about color, you know, obviously I'm a very unracist person, but being of color, you just growing up, you have a different set of points from your either your family, how you grew up, the music that you listen to, the food that you eat, and also the adversities that you have to overcome. And when you're creating music with that small perspective in your mind, the music is going to be different, you know? The ideas are different from, let's say, someone coming from Germany, you know, trying to recreate the idea of someone who's urban, you know? So that was just it's just a different conceptual idea. And then I created like an indie rock folk label because I like to listen to that stuff when I'm at home. Just why not, you know?
Three labels. It's interesting that you would feel the thing you take about cultural diversity, because when I started out, you know, the only place you could find house music or whatever when I first came to New York was Paradise Garage or Danceteria, and dominated by gay
black and Latino
gay black community and yeah. Latino. So actually the only place I could go to find that, and in Chicago, that's immediately what you got. So it would never strike you that that was the normal.
Switch back. Yeah.
But you'd think you'd get that in Panorama Bar as well.
A little bit, but you would think, but not so much. I mean, it is in Germany.
Okay.
That's not the most culturally diverse place in the world.
I thought Berlin was so cool. To tell us about Vision Quest, why? What happened to Vision Quest and you guys?
Because
you had a great label with an amazing logo, and you put out some great records.
Yeah,
and it was a family.
The label is still going. Really, it has hit a point where, I mean, I don't know how many people have worked in groups, but I'm a really boisterous person, you know? You know? Exactly. But it's like, no, it just got to a point where we were four people with four different ideas and four different points in our lives where we wanted our lives to go and what we really wanted to pursue, you know, musically or otherwise and conceptually, you know. And I'm also, like, again, a very loud person when it comes to concepts or anything, you know. So that's why I kind of started these three other labels, because these were ideas that I wanted to push. And at some point, there was I started to feel guilty in a way. Because any accomplishment that we would make as a team, I would get the credit for, you know, and that wasn't really fair to them. The other three artists who are also my really good friends at the time, you know, and not the time, but who are my really good friends. So it was like, it came to this point where I was like, okay, I'm in this group with these people. They're becoming a bit anti everything, because everything's always on my shoulders, or I'm getting the credit, you know, and it just became an uneasy situation. And it was the best for me to kind of step back. I'm still part of the group, but for them to take over, you know, like at some point. Also, how much work that Ryan and I, two of us, were doing compared to the other two was in proportionate, you know, which kind of also led to kind of group and, you know, like weirdness. So yeah, it was just the best bet, I think, for all of us to step back and allow them to grow as artists, you know. At some point, everyone has to kind of take control of their own life and their own career. And you know, it's good for them. They already have a really creative and incredible brand to work with. And then for them to be able to take the reins of that and now be credited for the accomplishments of that, I think is really good for everyone. And I could kind of step out and do all this other crazy crap I want to be, I want to be doing.
I mean, you might have answered it on the panel before, but I missed it. Would you play with them again now?
Yeah,
you're going to do the Vision Quest parties?
We're playing in the weekend. We're playing next weekend at Mysteryland. Yeah.
Okay. Music production has never really been your main focus. You're one of the rare few, much like my generation as well, where it didn't really rely on making music to break through as a DJ. But do you think now it's pretty impossible for a DJ to break through without releasing their own music?
I think it is. I mean, even when I came up, I had a string of releases in like 3 years. I had like maybe eight. It was like boom, 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 boom. It gets you the attention. I mean, that's the first thing, I think. When you release music, it becomes like your global calling card. It's like a global business card that you can get out.
CV, yeah.
Yeah, it's a CV, you know? And like the better labels you release on, you start to be considered in the same class as the artists that also release on those labels, you know? So it gives you definitely a kickstart. But now, after kind of years of globetrotting and stuff, I've come back to making music again. I just made, I think, I took 3 months off, basically, and made 9 new songs. And I'm really back into that idea of creating music. So creating music, I think, is very linked to kind of success within electronic music, and especially today. I mean, with how big electronic music is on radio around the world, as you know, having like, what do you have, like 100 radio shows?
A lot.
Yeah, a lot. And yeah, no, it's really important. I mean, and it's hard because there's so many DJs to really stand out again, and to be able to stand out, or at least to be even considered. I think coming up in the world, you have to at least make music. Yeah.
But do you think? Yeah, I mean, there's an English joke we have about buses, and this you know, you wait for one bus for years, and then three come at once. And you actually sent me about five tracks the other day, all in one go.
Yeah.
And then I lost them. And you sent them again. But so you sent me some amazing remixes, but your own music's coming, Seth Troxler music.
Yeah. Those are I just have to get mastered. But I've got like I think four single like EPs ready just for myself. Some stuff for a track, EP for Rumors, two on Tuskegee, and then I think one other one I can't really remember right now. Yeah.
If you were going to get discovered as a DJ, because I don't think you'd probably book anybody to play at your party unless you'd heard them play. You wouldn't just go, they sent me a cool track.
No, I mostly book friends. I mean, even to get on the labels that I work with or the labels that I'm running myself, it's all kind of friend-based. I mean, if you were just to be a DJ, I tell this to kids all the time, if you're just going to be a DJ out there, the way that you get involved is just being involved in the scene. You know, for so many years, I mean, even a reason I'm here today was so many years I was just going out to parties, and then eventually people realized that I DJed as well. They're like, oh, yeah, you're Seth, you DJ? And I was like, yeah, I DJ too. But I kind of was known just for kind of going out and hanging out and being cool with people, you know? That's like another really good way. I mean, there's kind of a lot of people have done it, but just there's so many global events, you know. At some point, by going out to all these global events, being around and being kind of cool and funny, then everyone starts to remember you're that funny, cool guy who's at every event in the world, and you know, people have eyes. So it's like, oh, yeah, it's that guy again, cool. And they're like, oh, then you hear that guy play, and you're like, wow, that guy's really good, and he's really cool. And then it's like, oh, that's nice. And then it's like you hear him play again. They're like, well, that was really good. Maybe next time we do a party, we should give them a little support, you know? This year we've got this, there's this guy, Harvard bass, who I'm really, I love his music, and he's a really, really good guy. And he's spending the summer on my couch. You know, he's like, Seth, I'm broke. I'm gonna come over to Europe. I need a place to stay. And we're like, he's like, you know, I'm really into sleeping on couches. Can I sleep on your couch? And I was like, yeah, you can sleep on my couch here in Ibiza the whole summer. Just buy like food, you know? And like we all did that at some point, but he was out, he was around, I saw him all the time, and he was always really inviting and as well as talented. And then I was like, hey, that's how people work in this industry. I know when I started coming up, he has given me loads of opportunities and support, and I'm forever grateful of that, you know? But everyone along the way kind of gives you a little push, you know? And that's, you have to take those opportunities when you can and just be nice when you can, really.
I think it's quite one thing I learned last year, although I've known them for years, is that DC10, they still they do the old-fashioned way that was like 30 years ago. You send them a mixtape, and they really do listen to it. Because I got into a discussion about some DJs with Andrea and everyone last year, and they said, "Oh, let me pull out his tape." It was fascinating that they still do that.
Yeah, they're actually really deep on that.
And they sit there in the office and listen to it in Italy. So. Again, you might have covered this, but you announced a number of residencies for this year. Can you tell us why you decided to scale back the guest slots and work just with the same clubs and promoters?
Yeah, I mean, it went back to relationships more than anything. I mean, I have a lot of relationships with a lot of clubs or promoters, and I found myself, as many of you guys know, the last few years, things have gone kind of skyrocketed for me, and it was about figuring things out, you know? And after, playing a series of gigs that were well paid, but not, I didn't really enjoy myself. I found that like, hey, it'd be really nice to just do events that I was personally committed to, and I also felt some type of endearing, you know, relationship towards. You know, I really, and me and my agent, my amazing agent here, Steve Hogan, big ups. I love
him.
This guy. And the William Morris team, and it was just finding a balance. But now, I mean, since we've done that and switched back, I was talking with Steve yesterday, and I haven't had a bad gig, and I can't even count the amount of time where I'm really just excited to be at and play and to be part of just part of that situation, and then playing in environments and clubs that allow me to be myself. And that as an artist is really fulfilling, and you kind of get on a run as well where you're like, you're playing the music you want to play without having to change the style of music you play for the crowd, and you can really start to become yourself more and really succeed as an artist. So yeah, things are incredible like that. And I think by scaling back and taking less high profile gigs and instead taking the right gigs has made my life I'm just happier in general, and I'm performing better.
And you were never tempted to do the Seth Troxler night every
week? No.
Merchandising,
we got some things up our sleeves. I made sticky hands last year, or earlier this year, to give away in Miami. You know, it was like sticky hands when you're a kid. That's pretty funny. I did some other stupid stuff as well. But just trying to come up with like funny, odd stuff to give away to people is always fun. But as far as like creating my own kind of Seth Troxler brand, I just don't think it's time yet. And also, I'm so happy with the people I work with. You know, working with DC10 and being part of that family and creating a new team. Now working with the Martinez brothers and creating a brand with Tuskegee. It's like these fun, small projects are really kind of more entertaining with me. And I think there's just a big problem in electronic music right now with everyone wanting too much, you know, and trying to take too much cake, where it's like, hey, we're building right now. We're in a really pivotal moment of creating what's going to last and what the future is going to be like. That's kind of take a step by step, and instead of, you know, there's that great quote, it's like walk before you run, you know, and I figured out maybe I should stop running and walk for a little bit. It's kind of nice.
Okay, you're quite a controversial character. You're not frightened of expressing your views. The Thump piece came out recently. I've got to ask you about that. Well, let's start with the headline, because you say dance festivals are the best and worst places in the world.
Yeah.
So do you want to say your piece on that?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of different types of dance festivals. I mean, and the best case scenario, there's like Time Warp, which is like heaven. You know, you're at this festival, it's the content, the concept, the feeling behind it, the production, everything is perfect. You know, as a clubber, to be able to see that many quality artists in one go is kind of like a dream. You know, however, you can go to another festival, like let's say EDC New York. I did that last year, 2 years ago. I got kicked off the stage, literally thrown off the stage 5 minutes after my set for trying to see if I had a cable there, and it was in a parking lot. I couldn't even get like a water for myself. And the quality and the content of the production, it was just sad. You know, they call themselves talent buyers. They have no real interest in our culture or community. And that, as well as the kind of, I think, culture or ideas that they breed at their events is kind of the worst thing for our culture. So it's the best worst. I mean, like America, for example, I often call America the best worst country in the world, because we're kind of the best, but we also are kind of the worst. You know, that's how we roll.
Because I know you and I know the subtleties of what you're about and I know your sense of humor, it'd be easy for me to agree with almost everything you say. But I thought reading that piece again this morning, I've got to call you out on a couple of things. And one is obviously that you should acknowledge, in the same way that you know, I was able to get into house music by going to see Larry Levan, so you would say I was lucky. To many people in America that are getting brought into the market now, and I live there, obviously their first experience, the only experience they can have, is walking into EDC or to Ultra. So if they know no better, and yeah, that's their entry point, that's a good thing.
That's completely valuable, you know, and it's the trickle down. I remember, I was really lucky. The first parties I was going to were warehouse parties in Detroit, but there's a lot of trickle down, you know. I mean, I grew up even listening to Tony DeVitt and like some of the old hard house stuff and stuff, you know, and I got into my own things in my own way. But I think the real question is about the people who are putting on these events and the people in like this higher status, you know, people who of power to take it upon themselves and commit to giving out some quality or creating something. It's not on the fans, you know. The fans have nothing to do with it. The fans are just trying to go out and they're really enjoying electronic music again, which is great for everyone, you know, and I'm really enthusiastic about it. But I am a bit taken by how people are presenting electronic music who have the power to present it in a better way. That's
you point out in your piece you're a big fan of Tomorrowlands.
Yeah, huge fan.
And yet that is a place that celebrates a lot of music that revolved originally around a lot of music that you wouldn't necessarily play or like.
Yeah, exactly. But how they present that music and present those ideas, that's something I can like kind of connect with in a way. You know, they're presenting the culture and they're putting in, you know, if you know the Duncan and Liska, the people behind that, they're incredibly invested in electronic music and the love of electronic music for all the right reasons, you know? And, you know, when you're doing a big event like that, it is about numbers and it's about getting people through the door and presenting the ideas, you know? And it's musically, it's not that I'm so musically against a lot of this EDM stuff, you know? I kind of think, you know, people like Skrillex or David Guetta, I really respect because they're actually really good guys and they're invested in this because they love it and they're doing what they do. You know, everyone's doing what they do for their own reasons.
Hold on a minute. You did say, let's face it, EDM DJs are the worst ever.
Yeah, some. Yeah, yeah, most of them.
Except those two.
I accept those two artistically, you know, but also it's their character. And I think the character of a lot of the EDM people coming up is just low. It's very, very low in respect and honesty and kind of like just the general things that kind of our electronic music kind of stands for, at least from my perspective. You know, and that's been a bit.
But again, to a certain extent, Tomorrowland comes to America as Tomorrow World.
Yeah, yeah.
Which I played last year, which was an incredible event. But it probably couldn't happen without Dimitri Vegas and Like Mike, without Avicii being there, drawing in the...
Hey, Dimitri Vegas and Like Mike, actually, right. And you and I, we all have the same agent.
Right. So that's true.
There you go. You know, it's a small world at the end of the things.
I'm going to Detroit to Movement. On Sunday.
Okay,
Monday.
Really, I'll see you there, yeah.
And events like that have been running for years in America.
Yeah.
But do you want why can't that solve everyone's problem?
I mean, the thing is that is like a content-driven festival also from a different place, you know? I mean, it's the numbers in Detroit aren't the same as the numbers of people who are going to also these big EDM events, you know? I think it's a lot of that has to do with how they run the festival and the reasons and also the content that they deliver. I think Detroit is one of the best musically curated underground festivals in the world. It's not a mega, you know, it's a large festival, very much so. But also, like, the pricing, everything about it isn't about that idea, you know, and promoting this kind of plastic, fantastic idea, you know. That's a thing that puts me off. But also, this is coming from my view as, like, an elitist, minimal techno DJ who plays at DC10 every week. You know, what I say isn't the gold standard, you know. I'm just some guy talking who's got a big mouth, who, like, doesn't, you know, who's not afraid to, like, just shake it up a little bit and, you know, speak my mind.
But you acknowledge that through the bigger events, you can actually bring in more people and ultimately turn them on.
I completely validate that. And hopefully at those big events. And I mean, I also got to give it to, you know, EDC and these other people. They do have underground stations. So kids can go, you know, let's say they go to one thing and then they walk over and they see Rich playing and doing his enter concept. And they're like, wow, this is incredible. And that could change one person from someone who's going out, you're listening to one thing, into a lifer who's going to be here in 10 years supporting, sitting at a panel or sitting back. You know, I was one of those kids as well before. You know, I used to have huge fat pants. You know, I used to go like polo raver, polo up top, fat pants down low. That was like kind of our thing, you know, big kind of wide leg Janko type of situation. And, you know, I changed over the years. I'm not going to, like, go against that. But still, it's about, like, now that I'm a person later and I, you know, things are going well for me, I see how people who are in the position of success really can change the world or change the concept or the perception of how our music and our community is. They have the power and they just choose to use it in a way that I don't completely agree with. However, at the same time, they are bringing a lot of people in. And that it could benefit us all. Sorry.
I mean, one thing you say in the piece is you hope people's intellect actually will discern. You know, if they see the EDM DJ enough times, they might gravitate to something else.
That's a big problem in general. I think in the world, especially America. You know, we become like kind of a nation of idiots. You know, where even politically, you know, it's true though, politically and in other ways, there's so many people who are so, there's so little concern about intellect. You know, the fact that NASA just put out a huge report saying about the kind of environmental stability, and it's gonna like, we're gonna have an environmental collapse in 40 years. And people in our political system won't even like, you know, kind of look at that as truth. It's like, it's fucking NASA, you know, like, this is fact, this is happening. And they're just like, no, and rather look at Honey Boo Boo and kind of change like the dialogue or change the questions. And it's just like, that overlooking, and like kind of there's this idea in America of this like undeserved confidence, you know, where people in America, and I can say this as an American, are like, you know, unknowingly, like so ignorant, but so proud of like being, you know, ignorant in a way, like, okay, like I don't know the answer to this, but I'm gonna step forward and say this is the right answer anyway, even though it's completely wrong. I guess in many cases I may be doing the same thing speaking about EDM, but I think I was coming from some point of reality.
Okay, just to finish off on the beat, a term that I'd never heard before, you talk about plur as well.
Oh yeah, that was
I've been around a long time, I'd never heard that before.
Oh, that's like the old rave term in America, dude.
Really?
Peace,
right, sorry.
Peace, love, unity, and respect.
There you go.
You get the kids with the candy bracelets, they're still rocking out to the plur vibes. But it's like, you know, I don't think it's so plur jumping off a stage and paralyzing someone in a rubber dinghy. That's not so plur, and then throwing a cake in their face. That's fucked up.
Listen, I'm sure when Avicii gets up here later, he's going to question you walking around naked swinging your cock around.
I'm going to come to that. I'm going to come to that talk, actually, yeah. We got some questions.
If you didn't think this man has got a sense of humor, have we got the video to play? This is not his cock coming out, by the way. This is something. We'll save that for
but
Friday.
That comes from a part
in
of
fact, we'll
art,
show that tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. to make sure you're all here. Can we run the video, as they say? Run the VT. What about this? This is his new party. I mean, directed by Tarantino. I think Butch was looking a bit like David Guetta there.
He kind of did.
He's modeling on. We're running out of time, so have we got any questions for Mr. Seth Troxler? You can get a word in. Don't be shy. We didn't even get to your restaurants, but we'll do that another time.
Hi, Joe Muggs. Do you envisage a better mainstream dance music in any way? I mean, I'm thinking in the sense of in the 90s, it actually filtered right into the mainstream in the UK with the Chemical Brothers, Underworld, so on. Could EDM produce those kind of acts?
I think electronic music is producing those type of acts, and it's just about getting it over and getting it on the radio. I mean, right now, I mean, the UK is in a really amazing position where UK radio, the DJs pick what's on the radio. And I mean, I wish we had some more time because I actually had some questions to ask Pete about this, being, you know, one of the greatest radio announcers of all time and really one of the greatest promoters of our music globally, you know, and having moved out to LA, the differences of how UK and American kind of promotions and radio culture really work. You know, and also how do you physically keep up? How do you do it, Pete?
All these guys on the phone the whole time. I think I don't sleep very much. I listen to a lot of music, but for me, I don't know. It's a different answer to a different question, but my theory about American radio that I'm pursuing is to be like a bit of a Trojan horse, to use the Greek thing, of actually just doing doing enough of one thing to get a big enough platform to be able to push through the thing you really want to play, kind of thing. And that's not like a personal conceited thing. It's more bringing things that are really successful in Australia or particularly in the UK, where it's already proven to millions of people that love it. And we're talking about things like Route 94 or Duke DeMont or
those
these things.
Great pop records.
So records that are like, you know, pop records in the UK, where they definitely won't put them on the radio yet in America, because they do think in straight lines. You know, I know with BPM, for instance, they won't play Duke DeMont because it's not EDM, which just is mad to me. You know, it's like, it's just a good record.
Yeah.
So hopefully I can exploit that and create another platform for that. So just listen to a lot of music. So
that's it, right there.
But be very aware of what is popular as well, though. I mean, that's the fine line, like you say. I mean, we'll debate about it later. But there are some EDM records that are pretty good, and there are some that are not so good.
I would like to hear those, Pete.
In my opinion, let's have a party back at yours.
Yeah. One last question, I think, or two. There's a few here.
Hi, Seth. My name is Marcelo.
Yeah, we know each other.
Yeah, nice to see you again. I would like you to comment on my parallel. I see Steve has the craziest DJ touring agenda, like playing 250 shows a year. Steve Aoki.
Okay, yeah.
And he's also created a new level of interaction with the cake, with the rafts and stuff. I see it somehow happening to you also, creating a new kind of interaction with getting naked, that bringing the titties back to the parties. don't you see this more than a lack of culture is like the new trend of culture now?
Yeah, no, you're completely right. There are a lot of parallels between Steve and I, and actually the future. We were speaking about this, I think I was speaking about with my management. There's a lot of DJs, or a lot of people are. You have to create your own personal brand, you know? Like, the age of the faceless DJ is almost ending, you know? Faceless, nameless, you know, the age of the underground resistance, you know? That was classic techno kind of idealism, you know?
Or Tenaglia, DJing behind a curtain.
Yeah, Tenaglia, yeah. DJ. He DJed behind a curtain, Danny? Oh, wow. Yeah, but those days are done. I mean, I think a lot of kids are going out for a show as well, you know, and like, where as far as musical content, I try to keep it very serious. I also realize the realities of the work that I work in, you know, the job that I have, and that's creating dreams, creating ideas for kids, you know. Kids, even though I'm against a cake in the face, it's the idea of being part of something and getting a cake thrown at you that's intriguing to people, you know, because they're part of something that's bigger. They're at a festival, they're part of this energy of, you know, thousands of people, and they were taken out of it. So that's amazing, and that's something that is becoming very, very real and something that we have to look at. You know, it's about how people, or how brands and how artists are created. You know, if you look at every big artist today, they all have a personal brand, you know? I think we got to wrap it up.
One more.
The girl back here in the cowboy hat, or guy, you had a
Any
question
ladies
last
in
time.
The house?
Let's get the, yeah, la- on, let's get the lady here. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, you had a question on the last panel.
Hi there, I'm Skin. You know, it's crazy because I think that throughout musical history, you've always had these like scenes running along each other that in many ways have kind of like hated each other, but not so much in dance music. I mean, why do you think what's your thoughts about the way that in some ways dance music seems to be almost splitting into two sides over EDM?
Oh, it's kind of like the Confederate Army versus the Americans, I guess. I don't know. I guess people just get salty. It's really more than anything. I mean, there shouldn't be a war, and we should be happy for everyone, you know. And at the end of the day, like Pete said, we are happy that actually all the things that EDM stands for and the MA and that, like, actually is very positive for electronic music as a whole. You know, it's bringing in a huge culture, and it's creating something larger that, you know, 10 years ago I could have never thought. Even when I started doing this, I never could have thought I could even make this into a career, let alone be up here speaking on a panel. And, you know, Pete's been in this game forever, you know, and to see the ebb and flows of how electronic music has kind of gone, and then to the point we are today is pretty amazing. We got to wrap this up. But, yeah, I think really more than anything, it's just something people want to talk about, because people are just people. You know, you gotta fight something. You know, but thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Good to finish. Thank you, Seth Troxler.
Yeah, thank you.